People that are completely unique, you don't so much admire them as just marvel at them.
I was sitting in the living room with my mum and my auntie, and it came on the radio.
What a voice, yeah, fantastic. And I always liked his stuff, bought his records.
My mum and my auntie were like going, "Oh, it's too sexy." I remember that you said
goodbye. All of us, in studying the craft of making a good record, had studied Roy's work.
In many ways, my whole life is been fashioned subconsciously by him.
The way he was and the way he sang made him dead cool.
Pretty difficult to find in Glasgow. Like, when you look about shops, you want a pair of Roy Orbison sunglasses. Golden days before they
end. I think Roy and England had a love affair. I mean, Roy loved the British and the British loved Roy.
By the 1980s, Roy Orbison's status as a living legend was well and truly confirmed when some of the biggest names in the music business queued up to be in the backing band for his Black and White Light concert.
Roy and I talked about doing a show that would be a performance show for Roy. So we set a time, finally, September 1987. I couldn't help but
see. It had been a while since people had focused on Roy's music quite this way. A lot of care was taken to do the songs justice the way I believe the show does.
I'm being asked all the time how this wonderful cast came together. Everybody just seemed to be available at that particular time. If we would have done it a month before, a month later, I don't think everybody could have been there.
I don't think the entire ensemble was put together until we were all on the set at the Coconut Grove in the Ambassador Hotel. I know Bruce Springsteen arrived at the very last minute.
How did you end it?
My big memory of that night was Bruce arriving, I think, for the sound check, and then realizing that his memory of the songs was not the same as the ability to play them.
And then you go.
You might
want
to go on,
mate. Yeah, I may have to.
When he actually looked at the charts, realised that there were odd counts in some of the songs, and I have an image of him sitting with his guitar, with like a cassette Walkman, comparing what he had obviously memorised over a couple of decades since the records came out to what was written on the page, and frantically kind of closing the distance between the two things if he was going to play on a couple of these songs. And I thought, well, that's really the measure of how much he loved Roy, because he was really dedicated. Sweet dreams, baby. Oh, how long must I dream? Okay. Yeah.
Sweet dreams, baby. Orbison clearly inspired anyone who was anyone in music. But just where did all the raw talent come from? Born in 1936 in the small town of Vernon, Texas, from an early age, Roy was single-minded in his pursuit of a career in music.
My mom and dad gave me a guitar when I was 6 years old. I always wanted to be a singer. My father asked me when I was about six or seven, maybe even earlier. I don't know whether I was playing the guitar at the time or not, but he said, what are you going to be when you grow up? And I said, I'll be a singer. I was able to get on a radio show when I was 8 years old,
an amateur hour, and I showed up so often that they made me a part of the show. And when I was 14, I think, I'd moved to West Texas and formed a group. Well, we were from Wink, Texas, and so we were the Wink Westerners. When we got a bit more popular, we became the Teen Kings. We'll hang out and raise the fun.
We'll stay out till after one. We met him the first time in Odessa, Midland, Texas. He had a group that played on a local television show there, and the song was called Ooby Dooby.
I made a demonstration record called Ooby Dooby and sent that then to Sam Phillips in Memphis, Tennessee. He asked me could I be there in 3 days. And so I grabbed my group together and we made the record, and I dropped out of the university, the junior college that I was attending then, and went on the road within 2 or 3 months.
What I thought at the time was the smallest voice was Roy Orbison. Sam Phillips said he had to put the microphone down his throat to pick him up. But I think Sam had the wrong kind of microphone, because his later records prove that he's not only got a great, strong voice, but he's one of the greatest singers in our business. But he saw his own potential, as did others, and he moved to a bigger label and had bigger records. Pretty woman, walking down the street, pretty woman,
the kind I like to meet, pretty woman. Searching for ways to fulfill that potential, Roy looked across the Atlantic to an early 60s music culture in Britain that was more than ready to embrace something new. Mercy.
In the early 60s, I worked for Decca as a promotion man. And my job, apart from promoting records, was to look after all the American artists who came to London. I was 21 years old, and it was a dream job. Are you lonely just like me? Very American, Southern, polite. And that was my initial impression of Roy. Very softly spoken, very polite, very appreciative. He was a gentleman, a real gentleman, actually. And that's what, you know, that's kind of rather sweet Southern States of America charm that he had. Pretty paper, pretty ribbons of blue. Wrap your presents to your darling from you. Pretty pencils to write. And he would invariably come with his wife, Claudette, and his boys. And they'd have a little apartment. And I would spend a lot of time with them as a family, because they were very family. And he loved having the boys around. He loved having Claudette around. And so I became part of their family. Downtown shoppers, Christmas
is nigh. There he sits. He always reminded me of like a preacher. He was so gentle. Very, very sweet. Loved his kids, loved the family. He was just a lovely guy. I mean, we were all mental. We were young and mad. Roy was very... very polite American, you know, he was very sweet. We were scousers, hard cases, nutters. He was a gentleman.
We were idolising Americans at this point, you know. We had Cliff and we had Tommy Steele, but...
we were just kids from Liverpool who knew nothing, following Roy Orbison, a massive star whose songs we'd sung for years, and we're there with him and watching him. Yeah. A dream. Well, I got a woman to mean as she can be.
But sometimes I think she's almost meaning me. The Brits were so enamored of American, of rock and roll. They possibly appreciated them more than the Americans did.
You know, the songs seemed more hip and the performances were more hip, and that's what we were all about. I think any
British recording artist from that period would probably tell you the same thing.
Though Britain was hungry for all things American, Roy's first UK tour would turn out to be an unexpected test of just how loyal his British fans might be. An all-English musical phenomenon was sweeping the country. Roy found himself sharing the bill with the Beatles.
You know, from what George told me, they were so starved of rock and roll and how they waited for the records to come out, and they knew there was this thing going on in America, but so for them it was just something that they were really hungry for.
The Beatles responded to Roy with total admiration. I can't emphasize how much American artists were the thing to admire, you know, and all things American.
Before I joined the Stones in the late 50s, I thought he was fantastic. And then he toured with the Beatles, 63.
The Beatles were on the tour with us, the Beats, Ourselves and Roy. Massive tour. 1963 was a great time for me. It was my first record, first number one, and my first tour with Mr. Roy Orbison, who became a very dear friend and such a lovely guy.
George told me they followed Roy and they would stand in the wings listening to this big ending. And he said they'd be just trembling, thinking, how on earth are we going to go out and follow this?
And his last note was 47 miles high in the sky. And the kids said, whoa.
In spite of the fact that the Beatles were getting this huge acclaim from the British public, right from the word go, really, from Love Me Do, it started. When Roy came on stage, he still had the goods to top them. He just stood there and sang. That's all he did. Didn't do anything else. I don't remember him putting one foot to the left or one foot to the right, to be honest with you.
I can't help it. I can't help it. If I...
That was what the impact was that he had the nerve to do that, to just stand there and let his voice do the work.
It's too bad.
Some people can do that. They just give off this aura with it. They don't have to move about. I've been trying to do it for 30 years, but it doesn't happen with me. So I stay in the shadows.
Well, in my case, when you see me perform, it's what happens is I sing, and the audience watches me do that. On opening night, I had between 7 to 15, 20 encores, and Paul and John grabbed me by the arms and said, Yankee, go home, whatever this, you know, and would let me take my last curtain call, but it was all in good fun.
And that voice, my God, you so annoying, but you're so good.
Each place we go, I'm so afraid.
He'd sing Running Scared and his mouth would go, just running scared, like this, you know, this tiny little movement of the mouth. But and he'd get to the end of that song where it goes up and up and up and up, and his mouth still wasn't moving, not a lot, you know, like you know, I'm really going to give it the full whack. He'd just still stand there and his mouth would open slightly more. And now would come this incredible note. And I think that's what was so thrilling, because his modesty in combination with his vocal prowess was quite something to see.
You loved him so. Yeah.
The way he sang was different than we'd ever heard before. Elvis didn't do that. Roy did it. You know, and I think just a different...